except having the pride of secrecy. But his ritualistic order still remains to be highly scientific, beyond all existing religions, yet including and accepting all religions. So, it was his position as a ritualist also. And then he got trained in the military service of his day. And he worked in the military service of Egypt. And he was in one regiment, war regiment, working for Egypt. And when Egypt was defeated, he was taken prisoner along with other military fellows. And he was sent to Babylonia as a prisoner. Under some mysterious conditions, he was released. And then he made his own researches in his god science in Babylonia. And then he met the traditional masters called Magi, and he learned the sciences taught by those masters, especially about numbers and arithmetic, and their own Chaldean branch of astronomy and astrology, and the various branches of the then existing music, and he was accepted as a master of those branches. Then one of his ideals was to go to India. In those days, India was as much a center of learning as Egypt was. And then in India, he could have the access to many grandmasters of wisdom. And he was a pet student in a science called Brahmavidya, the wisdom of the cosmic consciousness, a branch of which is called Atmavidya, which means the wisdom of the I am in us. The one is used as the key to the other. The other is used as the key of the one. This is how the tradition goes. And he received all the Vedic secrets from the masters of the Vedas. And in India, he was given a title, Pithaguru. So, when he returned to his motherland, the title was taken as his name. In Greek, he was called Pythagoras. The word Pythaguru in Sanskrit, the word Pitha means an international center of learning. Guru means a spiritual master. So, he was called a spiritual master of international learning of India. And the title was taken as it is. And when he returned to Greece, he was received by the international title. And it became his name afterwards. So, we can clearly understand Pythagoras was not his name. It was his international name which was conferred upon him internationally. So, in fact, it was not a proper noun at all. Just as we have in India the name Vyasa, the author of the Indian scriptures. It's not a name. The word Vyasa means a compiler of many branches of wisdom, almost equivalent to what we say the editor of great books. So the name Pythagoras also used in the same sense. And when he returned home once again, he reached almost his middle age. His people received him with great affection and honor. And he started his career as a spiritual master. He found that time was being wasted because he expected that people come to him and learn much from him. He was much disappointed. People were honoring him but not learning anything from him. He was glorifying him, calling him a master, and they were popularizing themselves as the disciples of their master, refusing to receive instructions from him. He was very much disappointed and pained to know that people were not at all ready to go into the depths of wisdom. They were very much interested in the glamour of wisdom than the real experience and depth of wisdom. They wanted to be known as scholars and learned people than to learn wisdom. So within a period of 3 years, there were about more than 3,000 disciples who came to him and gradually went away from him because they were dreaded of him. Some people feared that he would teach mathematics and geometry, and almost all people feared that he was giving a practical teaching of behavior, which was the most uninteresting and inconvenient part of his teachings. So instead of becoming famous, he became notorious. Yes, he was rather unpopular than popular. In such a way, he was more popular than the scholars of the day, because an unpopular fellow is known by more people than a popular fellow. So he was dejected a lot. And he had to search for disciples. He used to make proclamations. People can come and study any subject under him. And he used to declare many subjects as being taught under him. But there were people who were attending conferences but not classes. So humanity is the same in every century. In some centuries it is more commercial, and in some centuries it is less commercial. But human nature remains the same. Those people were only as much interested as the people of 20th century in those sciences. And he caught hold of a few students whom he wanted to pay for their personal expenditure. So he used to give them money for food, clothing and living, and began to teach those disciples. They also went away from him, and no one could live with him for 1 year. Everyone was speaking bad of him because he was notorious of not having a tolerance. He never spared anyone about the matters of behavior and social conduct. He was never harsh in his thoughts or words. He never insulted anyone or ill-treated anyone. But he never spared anyone about behavior. If one wanted to live with him, he had to live according to his own behavior. And everyone has to imitate how he lives and do as much as he does. Otherwise, he can go away. So he never asked anyone to go away, but nobody could live and work with him because he was working almost all the time except when he slept. and responsible way of behavior was one of his continuous teachings. Everyone should feel the responsibility of how he spends time and how he works, what work he wants to do, responsible of how he thinks, and responsible of every sentence he speaks. That was something unbearable and horrible to others. Because generally, we want to be a bit loose and jolly in our way of behavior. We want to have a pleasant way of living. But he was always pleasant. And he was never unpleasant in his speech or behavior. People felt him, his presence, very pleasant. But they could not bear him quite close. So that they used to enjoy his presence once in every 4 or 5 days for an hour or two. During which time, they had a few conversations with him, a few sentences from him, which they found it too much for them to understand and to apply in their life. And then they felt too much saturated, and they had a stunning effect upon their minds. And then they went away. There was one student who could stand all his oddities. And that one student started with demanding money from him to leave. So Pythagoras paid him to be his disciple. But gradually the student became very affectionate. He got himself so much attached to Pythagoras lifelong that he stopped demanding from Pythagoras the money. Gradually, he paid everything of the expenses of Pythagoras in his life. And also, he helped a lot in Pythagoras having a residence and a college of his own. He was one of his direct disciples who always supported financially Pythagoras. And about Pythagoras, he had one sentence. That disciple had one sentence. That is, sunlight is more present than sun. And people rejoice in sunlight. They cannot look at this sun. That is about my master. That is what he used to express about Pythagoras. He meant that Pythagoras was like the sun. People can enjoy the teachings of Pythagoras, but they are not able to enjoy the presence of Pythagoras. That is how he felt. But yet he lived with Pythagoras lifelong. And let us go into a few angles of vision of Pythagoras. How he had his own point of view about the world and himself. He had his own peculiar way of expressing truths. That is the philosophy of life. Today, let us go into a detail of his oral teachings, which were essentially of a pleasant and a humorous nature, but very, very deep. The first teaching he made was, it is the duty of every spiritual student to see that there is one fool less in this creation before he dies, and that is yourself. This is one of his teachings. So, before one dies, he should see that there is one fool less on this earth, that is himself. And he should see that there is one more wise man on this earth, and that is yourself. The rest you can do what you please. This is the minimum that is expected of you. This is one of his teachings. second teaching he gave is, one who has no mastery over his time, his mind, his senses, his thoughts, is a slave to every creature in this world. This is his second teaching. Almost unbearable, because we all come under this. Until we have a mastery of our own time, any fool on the street can use us. That is what he means. There is a lot for us to think about this proposition. I think it will take about a decade or more before we can understand the full significance of this statement. Because it all depends upon how we understand our time and span. The more we can understand the significance of our span of life, how quickly it is spent, how speedily it goes away, and how it is ill spent by us often. Unless we know this, we cannot understand and appreciate this statement fully. We spend much time aimless. We spend many evenings and nights in the clubs. The card player spends evenings, nights and mornings. The weekend, whole weekend is spent in his own way. And what is the result? However speedily he plays cards with his friends, is there anything gained by way of satisfaction? So Pythagoras means that wisdom is satisfaction, and any knowledge that is not capable of causing satisfaction to you is only a mechanical activity, and the human machine is ill spent, and it has its own wear and tear, and we cannot make a compensation of the time we spend. Because when our span is spent, let it be 1 minute or 1 hour or 1 day, it cannot be brought back to do something better. We have to do only with the remaining span, and any span ill spent is spent forever. If money is spent, we can earn. If property is spent, we can earn once again. If an opportunity is spent, we can get it again. But if the time is spent, our span of life is spent, and there is no watch or clock which brings it back. So we feel more serious about this statement of Pythagoras the more we try to understand the importance of life. Then we go to the third teaching. Many people speak of seeking knowledge. Pythagoras said, seeking knowledge is running after yourself. And he says, your shadow runs with you. When you run in the sun, your shadow runs with you. And if your face is towards the sun, your shadow is at your back. It follows you. But if you face your shadow, sun is at your back, and you have to follow the shadow. The shadow runs in front of you, and your shadow is your body and its needs. That is what he teaches. I personally feel that we have to spend one full span of life before we can understand this completely. Just we have to offer our mind to this thought and live a life before we can understand its significance fully. The body is made up of flesh. it has its own desires, appetites, the taste for food and taste for drink, the need for rest and need for sleep, and the need for sex. Beyond these needs, there are desires that are utterly false. For example, there is a need for food, but there is also a desire for food. There is a need for drink, but there is also a desire for drink. A need for sleep, a desire for sleep, and the need to work, but a desire to do some work which we like, and the need for sex, the desire for sex. We should be able to know the demarcation line. Need is true, desire is utterly false. When you are behaving with the needs of yourself, you are facing the sun, the spirit in you, the light, the source of enlightenment in you, the original source of illumination in you, which is the content of the soul. The soul and the spirit put together, they form the unit of light in you. And facing the sun means living in the awareness of the soul and spirit, called a continuous God awareness. When you are living in your own awareness, then Pythagoras says you are facing the sun. Then your desires and the body is behind you. When you live as soul and spirit, when you are identified with spirit, then you are no more identified with your body. Your body is only a shadow, because it is provided by nature to serve you as a vehicle. And it has a few needs which you are expected to fulfill. Beyond that, everything is desire. And if you are interested in it, then you are facing your shadow. You are trying to serve your body. From morning to evening, we do our service to our hair, to our skin, with the help of many perfumes and cosmetics, doing faithful service to every part of the skin and every hair on our head and up to the boots, polish, we are polishing our own shoes. So from head to foot, we are doing 24-hour service to the hair and the skin and the shoes and the garments. The result is, we live as lifelong servants of the skin, servants of hair, and servants of garments, and servants of shoes. This is what is called running after the shadow. Then your sun will be behind your back. This is a little bit of explanation of his statement. But this is not enough. Everyone has to meditate and find out. And he says, let there be a noon to everyone when there is no shadow around you. Only when it is noon, if you stand on the street, you have no shadow either behind or before. He says, let there be a noon to you. And then he explains what noon is. It is called the point of initiation, when the sun is over your head. It is also technically called by Pythagoras the time of high 12. High 12. He had two peculiar terms. High 12. And low 12. That is, when you are standing on this earth, if the sun is above your head, It is called height valve. That is the noon. When the sun is below your boots, it is called the low 12 or the zero time in night. And there are two more points. The east, where your sunrise is, your west, where the sun sets. These four are called the four cardinal points of the day. And this is the time. That means you are expected to stand erect, not only physically, but also mentally and morally. It is what is called straightforward nature. Straight thinking, straight speaking, and straight doing. If you like someone, say I like you. If you don't like someone, say I don't like you. But don't say to others, I don't like him. You can straight tell him that you don't like him. But don't speak to a third person that you don't like so and so. This is what is called straight or vertical living. And he called them the value of the verticals. That is what we mean, the personal virtues and individual virtues. Personal discipline. As against what he called horizontals. That means the social virtues, our behavior towards the society and others. That is including others. For example, compassion, love, tolerance. Those are called horizontal virtues. Whereas personal discipline is called the vertical virtues. And he called the verticals the plumb. He said, hang some weight to a string. It can be only vertical and it cannot be otherwise. Unless you disturb it like a radiesthesian. If you do not disturb it, it will point to only the earth's geographical center of that place. It is called the verticals. And the horizontals, he called it the spirit level. These are called the implements used by a builder of a building. Those are called the implements of masonry. Used in Freemasonry also, only as oral symbols. No necessity of practicing in life. Because we practice for 1 hour in every month in the rituals. It is a mockery. But Pythagoras called them the implements of masonry. And he meant the operative masons and not speculative masons. But in Freemasonry, we boast of being speculative masons and not operative masons. So we are as useless as dust, unless we are operative masons. Unless we put into practice these virtues in our daily life. How many years we may be members of any ritualistic society, we try to observe them only in the ritual hall and not in the life. Then we are called the speculative masons, absolutely useless fellows, because we are not building any temple on the solid plane. Pythagoras called these two as the two implements of the mason. And he said, water finds horizontality. If you take water in a container, you can tilt the container in whatever way you like, but the water always stands on a horizontal surface.